Yeah, okay, but welcome to Deal Jabber, yes. Okay, so we're going to be talking, we're going to start by talking about using tables. Okay, so remember, we're going into y equals. So what I mean by this is anytime you see an equation, you should stick it in y equals. If you see y equals something, you probably want to put it in the calculator. There are 15 to 16 questions on the test that you can solve 100% exclusively using your calculator and like nothing else, okay? You don't even necessarily have to know any algebra, okay? I mean, you kind of do, but you don't have to like, you don't have to really understand, you can get 15 questions right just using the calculator, okay? So remember, y equals, we're going to go into y equals. To get to the table, we do second graph. To make change window settings, we do second window, okay? So let's start by looking at a couple of questions. So I'm going to go through a few of these with you, and then a few of them you're going to do for homework. So the first one I want to go over is question number 3, which used to be question number 8, okay? Now, what I'm going to show you, and again, remember, some of these skills you may, when we do these, you may think, I don't quite know how to do that skill. We're not learning, we're calculating skills. So don't be too focused on the skills, but think about, okay, we're talking about transformations. Maybe I need to practice that, okay? I want you more focused on the calculator part today. So for this one, it says, a baker determined the annual profit in dollars. And honestly, I don't really care what's happening at this point. All I know is that I see a function here. I don't know if this highlighter will show up, but no, that's 100% useless. All right, let's use the green. I see a function here, so I'm sticking it in my calculator. If I see a function, it goes in my calculator. It's going to go into y equals. Okay. Now you can see the calculator better. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to take this function and we're going to put it in y1. So 52x minus 0.05x squared. Why am I using x? Because we always use x, okay? We always use x, okay? Now I'm going to go to the table, okay? Now when I look at the table, I go second graph and get to the table, it's at 0. And they're saying, okay, it says n is the number of pies sold, which means I need to go to x equals 400, and I'm not about that life. So how can I jump in the table? No, plus, well, yeah, I guess you could do that. Plus changes what it jumps up by, but I can go to second window and make my table start at 400. Okay, so to change to jump, so let's write this down. To jump to a value, we want to do second window, and then in table start, we're going to make whatever we're trying to jump to. So I'm trying to jump to 400. Now when I go back into the table with second graph, I'm right there at 400, which has a dollar value of $12,800. Now notice I didn't cross anything off. Why didn't I cross those answers off? Why are they wrong?
Because we already saw the answer.
Yeah, but did I prove that they were wrong?
No.
If you don't prove they're wrong, you don't cross them off. If you didn't personally eliminate those, if you don't know what, now I can actually cross off H because second period, I accidentally put 52N plus 0.05N squared and I got that answer. So I personally know why because I messed up. But I don't know why the other two are wrong. I don't know how they got those answers. Okay. Anything. I never eliminate anything. Okay. Go. Period. Okay, what questions do you have about that? So this, we were practicing how to jump to a value. Okay. Let's take a look at this problem here. Now, I want to talk before you start. So those of you who immediately reach for your calculator, you're right. This should go in the calculator. Okay. Will this one work? Oh, I'm pretty sure it's not going to work.
No,
that's the no, definitely not. Okay, so I guess we're going with green. Alrighty. Okay, so let's talk really quickly about this bubble grid. Tell me, no, stop calculating and start and look at this bubble grid. Tell me what you know about this problem. About, because it's a bubble grid, tell me something that you know.
You can't guess.
Well, you can't guess. What else do you know? It's not going to be a fraction. Some of y'all on the practice star, literally, I'm not joking, wrote 1/4. Don't do that. Like, right over the bubbles, wrote 1/4. If you don't see a slash on here, you can't put in a fraction. Okay? Okay, let me tell you what I know. I know there's an answer. I know what the answer isn't. It's not no solution, and it's not infinite solutions. Because I can't bubble no solution or infinite solutions. I can't bubble that on here. So there has to be an answer. Here's the other thing I know. It's not going to be something weird. They don't tell me to round. So it's not going to be like that. It's not going to be an irrational number. It's not going to be a non-terminating repeating number. It's not. It's going to be something that terminates. So it might be like, it might be that, right? But it's not going to be something that doesn't terminate. It's going to be, there's an answer. So whenever I see a bubble grid, I know there's an answer, and I know it's not going to be, unless they tell me to round, which they really don't in algebra, it's going to be something I can bubble, and I don't have to, there's no guesswork. So if you get something weird and it's a bubble grid, probably wrong. Okay? So bubble grids, in a way, are easier because I know they've got to be something. I know the answer is a number, and I know that the answer is something that I can bubble easily. It's not going to be something complicated, okay? So now that I know that, the way that we're going to do this one is if I see something equals something else, I put the left side in Y1, I put the right side in Y2, and I look for the X value when they're equal, okay? So I'm going to put the left side, so the negative 6x plus 8 goes in Y1, the 4 times 17 minus x goes in Y2, and again, I'm using x because I always use x. And then before you like go looking at stuff, just make sure you entered it right, because obviously that's my challenge. Okay, so negative 6x plus 8, 4, okay. Now I'm going to look at the table. Okay. Oh, yuck. Look, I'm at 400. What can I do? Second window, and let's start myself at 0. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. I start to scroll, and like, boy, that's probably something they're trying to get you to pick. Are 44 and negative 44? Pick that one. Okay? But I'm noticing that, like, as I go this way, it looks like they're just getting further, like, I don't think this is ever going to catch up. So I'm going to try going the other way. Now, the thing is, like, part of my heart might be saying, this seems like it might be no solution. But there has to be a solution because it's a bubble grid, okay? So I'm going to keep going. I'm going to keep scrolling, okay? But they're starting to get closer. I can see that they're starting to get closer. Okay, now they're really starting to get close, real close. They're both in the 200s. And boom, there we are. Y1 equals Y2. So when X is negative 38, Y1 is 220, and Y2 is 220. Which one's the answer, negative 38 or 220? Okay. X is the answer. Okay, whatever X is the answer. Now, let's pause, and I want you to talk. I want to talk about bubbling, okay? I'm going to bubble negative. I'm going to write negative 38, and I'm going to bubble a negative, a 3, and an 8, and then I'm going to put down my pencil and I'm going to walk away because, like, don't be bubbling extra stuff, okay? Now, you can put this 38 over here. You can put it at the end. I like to put it right next to the negative because it feels right to me, but you can put the 38 anywhere, but don't be bubbling extra stuff because you might be like, I'm going to bubble 38.0000, and then all of a sudden you accidentally bubble 38. 0 point 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 and it's wrong and you have the right answer. Don't bubble extra stuff, okay? If it's not negative, don't bubble positive, because knowing my luck, I'd bubble the negative on accident. Don't bubble extra stuff on these grids, okay? Okay? All right, let's try another one down. So questions about that. Are we okay with this? Okay, remember the X answer. Let's look at this one down here. Let's do the same thing. Try this one. Now, oh, hold on, pause. Before we try this one, let's think about it. It says, what's the positive solution to this equation? Okay, but what does that mean? If it can't be negative, what does it mean? It means one's a positive and one's a negative. It means you have two solutions. But you're right. It means that when I start looking at this, and I'm just going to go ahead and set my table back to zero, I don't care about negatives. I'm going to start looking in the positive direction, okay? So I'm going to put 4x squared plus 12x and 135. And then I'm going to look. Now, does anybody see the problem? What's the problem? It's like somewhere between two numbers. But what do I know? It's going to be a decimal, but it's not going to be a weird one, right? Mm-hmm. So, if I go back into my window, I can change what my table goes up by. I can make it go up by like, whoops, not negative, like 0.5. So I can, instead of making it go up one tick, I can make it go up half. Now let's see what we get. There it is. And if it was still in between two numbers, I'd make it go up 0.25, go up 1/4. Okay? I put the equation, that I put the left side in y1 and the right side in y2, just like we did up here. So yeah, so I put the left side in y1 and the right side in y2. And again, if I want to change that, okay, if I want to look at a partial, I'm going to do second window. And this time, I'm going to be doing this one, triangle table. And I'm going to make it 0.5. Triangle means change, always means change. Okay? And then I found, so the row that I found that looked right was x, y1, y2, 4.5, 135, 135. Which one's the answer? X, 4.5. So I'm going to bubble 4. I'm going to write 4.5. Some of y'all like to get fancy. You're like, I'm just going to bubble because I'm cool. Stop it. Write it down. That way, if you come back and check later, you know what you meant to bubble. Okay? And then I'm going to bubble a 4, a point, a 5, and then I'm going to back away from the paper, and I'm not going to bubble in anything else because I don't need to bubble anything else. It's not negative. Don't bubble extra stuff. Yes? You do it over here?
Yeah.
That's fine. Again, it doesn't matter. For this bubble grid, it doesn't matter where you put it, just as long as you bubble those numbers. But don't be putting extra spaces. Don't bubble extra zeros in the front or the backs. Okay? Just bubble in what your answer is and step away. Okay? Okay, the next one I want to talk about is the 31, now it's number 9. Okay, and the reason I want to talk to you about this one is because, so you see how I have fractions in the question, but I have decimals in the answer? If I use alpha y equals and put this fraction in the calculator, my y values it puts out are going to be fractions. So if I put fractions in, I'm going to get fractions out. So in order for me to get a table that looks like this, I need to put decimals in. And the way you do that is, instead of using alpha y equals, you say, so in y1, you'll say 15 times 5 divided by 6 to the x power. Okay? Now you can still do alpha y equals, but you might start getting some mixed numbers. So instead of getting 12.5, you'll get 25 over 2. And that doesn't look the same. So if you're trying to get decimals out, you got to put decimals in. Decimals in means you're not putting in alpha y equals. Okay? So let's put that one in. And remember, okay, so first of all, I'm going to fix my table back. So it starts at 0 and it goes up by 1. Okay? And actually, well, anyway, we'll worry about that later. And then I'm going to put this function that they gave me in, 15 parentheses, 5 divided by 6 to the x power. Okay, and remember, 2d is the caret button. And now I'm going to look at the table. Now I'm going to go back to negative 2. Negative 2 is not the same, because this one isn't right, so I'm going to cross it off. Okay? Now I'm going to do the next one. The next one is, and I don't know why mine's in Y2, but it is, 18 times 6 divided by 5 to the x power. 12.5, 15, 18, 21.6, 25.92. This is the one I want. Notice, I did not just cross off C and D because I have not eliminated C and D. Yeah, B is the answer I got, but I suppose it's theoretically possible. I could get the wrong thing for those too. So I'm not going to cross these off unless I choose to eliminate them all right now. If I don't eliminate them all right now, I'm going to leave them uncrossed off because if I have extra time, I can go back and eliminate those answers. Do you see what I'm saying? But there's no reason not to eliminate them now, but what I'm saying is don't cross them off until you have personally proven to yourself that they're wrong. They're not just wrong because they're not the answer you got. They're wrong because you saw that they were wrong. Okay? All right, so are we starting to feel good about the table?
Yeah.
Okay, any questions so far? Okay, great. So now let's talk about using graphs to get stuff right. So most of these questions have something to do with a graph. All right? Now, some of them still do have questions about the table, but we got a lot of graph stuff happening here. Now, let's take a look at this one. It says an exponential function's graphed on the grid. What function is best represented? Now, we should be able to eliminate. Basically, we shouldn't even. This is an eyeball question. But the reason I have this one in here is because I want to show you something. Yesterday, when we took our test on exponential functions, a bunch of you guys, there was a question on the test where it had four graphs and one expression, and like a bunch of y'all were like, I don't know what to do because all the graphs kind of look the same because all of the axes were different. So like one of them went from like, let's say negative 2 to 8, and the other one went from like negative 22 to 80. And they looked the same because they were playing with the scale on the axis. So if you see something like this, a strategy that you can use with the graph is, you're still going to put this in Y1, but what you can do is you can pick a couple of points, make yourself a little table with the function that you're looking at. On yesterday's test, because there were four different graphs, you can pick a couple of points off of the function they give you, and then look at each graph and see if it goes through those points. So in this case, I might say, okay, I have a point at 0, 6, I have a point at 1, 2. So let's put this in the calculator and see if that function goes through those two points, right? So the function is 6 times 1/3 to the x power. When I look at, I have 0, 1, 2. Okay. Now, just for giggles, tell me one thing that you should have eliminated.
The minuses.
Why should you have eliminated the minuses? You're absolutely right. Does my function, have we done any exponentials that had a plus or minus in them?
No,
they all were multiplying. We haven't done that. You might see that, but you're not seeing it in Algebra 1. What's wrong with B? Just from looking at it, what is it? So why does it need to be a fraction? So it can decay, right? This is growth. So, okay. All right. Okay, let's look at this next one. And again, the reason is because like, last year, this one you can solve with the graph, but you got to do a little elimination first. And we're going to talk, we have a day for odds and ends, which is little random stuff that doesn't really go anywhere. And we are going to talk about parallel and perpendicular. We're at least going to remind you about it. But remember, parallel has two L's in it. Parallel means same slope. Okay? Perpendicular is RO. Does anybody remember what RO stands for?
Reciprocal
opposite. Yep. Now, what does reciprocal opposite mean? So I have to flip the fraction, and I have to flip the sign. Okay. So I started with negative 4 ninths. If I flip the fraction, it's 9 over 4. If I flip the sign, it's positive. So my slope has to be positive 9 fourths, which means I can get rid of those two. Okay? So just knowing what I know about parallel and perpendicular, I can get rid of those two. Now, I could put this in Y1 and those in Y2, but let's be honest, that has a y-intercept of 81. I'm not going to be able to see it. But they give me this other piece of information. It says it crosses the x-axis at 36. If it crosses the x-axis at 36, what is that ordered pair going to be? 36, 0. 0, 36 would be if it crossed the y-axis, 36, 0. So I can literally put this equation in my calculator. 9 divided by 4, x plus 81. I'm sorry, I'm going to change my table set. I don't want to be scrolling, so I'm going to have it jump me to 36. That's 36, 162. That isn't it. Okay, let's try minus 81. 36, 0. Okay. Do I ever have to come back to this question?
No,
because I have 100% eliminated. I have eliminated everything but this one. So do you see what I'm saying when I say, like, we cross off? And a lot of times, like, you may notice I crossed off what was wrong with it. Because that way, if I come back and look at it, like, okay, why did I do this? Then I know why I eliminated that answer. I know I eliminated it because the slope was wrong. Okay? All right, next one I want to look at is number 17 on the next page. And again, I just want to set your expectations. We're going to spend a whole day we're going to spend on inequalities, all right? But I do want to show you a feature in the calculator that we can use. Now, the first thing, I can put this in the calculator because it's in slope-intercept form. If it was something like this, I'd have to do a little bit of work before I could put it in there. If it was in slope-intercept form, if it was like this, I'd have to do a little bit of work. I can put it in the calculator, but I gotta do a little work first, okay? But if it's already in slope-intercept form, meaning if it's got y by itself, I have a button with y by itself, I can stick stuff in there, okay? So, this doesn't help me pick out the boundary line, but it will help me pick out the shading, okay? So let's go ahead and put the 3x minus 4 in y1, okay? And then I'm going to arrow to the left. So you remember when we did the fat line? Mm-hmm. I'm going to hit enter, and there's the fat line. If I hit enter again, this line's pointing up. So it's greater than. Is greater than pointing, do you think greater than is up or down?
Up.
So this is pointed up. Now when I hit graph, it shades above the line. Okay? So with that, I can immediately cross off those two because the shading's in the wrong place. Okay? Huh? Okay, let me show you again what I did. Hold on, let me get back there. Okay, it started off with the regular line. So I'm over here on the left. And I hit enter until this little arrow is pointing up. If I hit enter one more time, it's pointing down, and then when I hit graph, it's going to shade below. Okay? So I want it pointing up. So. And then when I do that, it shades above the line, so I can tell which one. So it's got to be one of these two. Now, the thing that you got to remember is, if it's angry guy, then it's dashed. If it's angry guy who's also tired, it's solid. Because he needs a solid 8 hours of sleep before he gets those bags out from under his eyes. Okay? So angry guy is dashed. Angry guy with bags under his eyes, solid. Okay? So what do I have here? Do I have dashed or solid?
Dashed.
So I can cross off these two solid lines, which the only one I haven't crossed something off on is D. So that's my answer. Okay? Okay. Now, again, some of these could be considered eyeball questions, but you can answer them with the calculator. Okay? So let's look at number 16, which used to be 38. Well, do y'all have any more questions about that? angry guy with the bags. Okay, good. And we are going to spend like either a whole day or half a day on inequalities. Okay, so, you know, because we were not great at them. Systems and inequalities together is 8 to 9 questions, so we want to make sure that we have them unlocked. So let's take a look at this. 10 times 0.85 to the x. It says which graph best represents it. Which two should I immediately eliminate? Y, H, and F. Because they're growth and I want decay. Okay, these two are decay. Okay, now, if I just put this in my calculator, if I put 10 times 0.85, whoopsie, that's not even right, 10 times 0.85 to the x power, I mean, I think it's this one, but what I can do is I can make my window look exactly like theirs. So if I hit the window button, I can change, because if I notice, both of these go from negative 5 to 15, negative 5 to 15. So I can make mine look like that too. So my lowest x is negative 5, and I'm not talking about domain and range here, I'm talking about the grid. And my highest x on the grid is 15, oh, no, that's not it, negative 5. So my max x is 15, my minimum x is negative 5, and my maximum x is 15. I'm sorry, minimum y is negative 5, my maximum y is negative is 15. Now when I hit graph, it looks just like them. Like the grid is the same and everything. So which one is it?
G.
It's totally G. Okay. Now, I didn't eliminate J because if I have time, I can go through and kind of be a little more detailed and, you know, maybe see if I can find a point. You know, like maybe I don't know where there's a point. Like, I'm not even sure. So like 0, 10, 1, 8.5. What'd I do with the menu? With window, I change the x and y's, the minimum x and the maximum x, the minimum y and the maximum y. And I made them match the minimum x and y on this grid. Okay? So that's a way that we can use the window settings to help us. And I actually saw some of y'all do that. Some of y'all have done that on a couple of tests. Okay. Now this one I'm going to show you. But I want y'all to understand we're going to spend like half a day in transformations. But I want to show this to you because you're going to be like, why didn't you show us this before? And here's my answer, because I like literally just learned about it. Okay? So I wasn't trying to. I'm going to clear RAM on my calculator really quick, just because I want to have a clean slate for this. Okay, so this requires you to be able to enter Y1 in your calculator. I also found another way to do that. So I'm going to show y'all this. Okay, so we have to know this anyway, and we're going to spend Monday kind of going over this. What is the quadratic parent function? What does a parent function mean? It's the basic one. It's like the simplest one you can have, right? What is the simplest quadratic function we can write? Yeah, y equals x squared. This one also, it says the linear parent function. What's the simplest linear function we can write? Y equals x, okay? These are our parent functions, okay? And we build from there. Maybe we make them steeper on the sides. Maybe we shift them around, okay? But these are our basic functions, okay? All right. So what you do is you go into y equals and you put the parent function that you're looking at in y1. Okay? Now, you're going to, in the second row, you see where it says F?
Yeah.
We're going to replace F with Y1. Now, okay, hold on. Do you guys remember how to get to Y1?
No.
Good, then I'm going to show you a different way.
Okay.
Hit alpha trace.
Oh.
And then just hit enter. I want Y1. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to rewrite this F of X plus 2 minus 5. But wherever there's an F, I'm going to put Y1. So F, Y1, X plus 2 minus 5. So you see how all I did there was wherever I saw the F, I put Y1. Now when I hit graph, it shows me the parent function and then it shows me the new one. So what's the answer? It's H. Huh? The problem is this isn't x, it's x squared. See? So what I told you guys in the past was just leave off the x, but the problem is this isn't linear. This is quadratic. Yes, sir. Absolutely. I'm going to do it again, okay? Okay, I'm going to do the whole thing over again. Okay, so I start by putting in the parent function. That's not it. I start by putting in the parent function, x squared, y equals x squared. Okay? On the next line, so that's the original. Now I'm putting in the new one. Okay, the new one is f of x plus 2 minus 5. Instead of f, I'm going to put y1. All right? Well, to get to y1, I hit alpha trace. And then I just hit enter. Okay, so you with me so far? And then I'm going to put everything that's after the f in the equation. So, parentheses, x plus 2, close parentheses, minus 5. And then I hit graph. There's the parent function. And here's where it moved to. Which one looks like that? H looks like the new function. Okay? Now, and again, not that this matters, but if you pretend that you're like kind of confused because there's a lot going on, if you arrow over to the equal sign and hit enter, it won't graph that one. It'll only graph the new one. Yeah, there's a lot of things. I'm trying not to overwhelm y'all with the calculator, but yeah, so anyway, you mean like you are now? So what are you going to do on this one? Just for the heck of it, what will we put? Tell me what we would put in the calculator on this one. So for y1, I would put y equals x. Clear. I'm just going to clear both of these. Y equals x. Now, this one says negative f of x plus 3. So I'm going to put negative y1 parentheses. I don't even need to put the... I can put the x in there. Minus 3. I'm sorry. Thank you. But I'm going to put it in the calculator right. It was plus 3. Sorry about that. Okay. There's my parent function. Here's the other one. Which one does that look like? G. Looks like G, because that's the answer. Okay. Now, really quickly, before we go to lunch, I want to talk to you about this. Okay, when you see a problem like this, yeah?
I have a
you have a question, hon? You have a question?
Yeah, what?
Where did I enter in y equals? The parent function, y equals x. Yeah. So you always put the parent function in x, and then you put what you're transforming in y. I put what's up here. Mm-hmm. Okay. So for a question like this one, folks up, for a question like this one, whenever you see the word equivalent, that means you're going to put your original in Y1, and then one after the next, you're going to put these into Y2. And I want the whole table to have y1 equals y2. So I don't just want one of them to be equal. I want every single row in the table to be equal. So again, what that would look like is I would put x squared plus 15x minus 54 in y1, and then I would put this one in. So I would put x plus 9 times x minus 6. And then I'm going to go into the table and I'm going to look. Is every single row equal? No. Now the first row is, but are the rest of them?
No.
Nope. So I cross this one off, and then I try the next one. So that's going to be x plus 18 times x minus 3. And when I look at this one, is every single row the same? So I circle it. If I choose not to check these, I don't cross them off, okay?